You all know me, I'm Dee from Gingham Kids Nanny Agency, and of course we do recruitment and provide childcare services for all of your families out there. Except providing the childcare services, of course, looking after children is a very important task and very challenging task most of the time. Therefore we provide families and nannies in training. A lot of the training is around the childcare development and everything else. We offer paediatric first aid trainings and everything else. But of course, more and more we are getting people asking me about children with learning difficulties. That is something that as an agency we find very hard to answer. Although we have years of experience, we are not the experts in that. And I was absolutely delighted to come across Sue Cook, who is a neurodevelopmentalist. And she has a degree in health science from the Westminster University of Westminster, 17 years of practice, 7 out of those in neurodevelopmental in children and actually adults as well. Sue is a published author and has actually a book that has recently been published as well. And I believe you have been called the Child Brain Whisperer by somebody in Australia. So please welcome Sue Cook.
Hello everyone, thank you for coming to see me. So you're wondering how I came to be standing in front of you today, what puts me here, and how I got involved in learning issues. When my son was born, he was the strangest little thing I'd ever seen. He simply never stopped moving. He cried all the time. He was quite a challenging little chap. And I'd say to my friends, he's really hard work. And they'd say to me, babies are difficult. And I'd say, but some babies sleep in the day. Toby never did. At 3 months old, he would wiggle across the floor on his back. By 8 months old, he would walk 2 hours a day. So while we were outside, he had a verbal education. By the age of 18 months, we'd walk all day, 9 to 5. So while we were outside, we walked and we talked about the sun and the moon and the stars, nature, what was going on in our environment. He seemed to be a bit of a natural quantum physicist. He could discuss quite advanced quantum physics at the age of 3 and 4. And people said to me, you've got a genius on your hands, you wait till he starts school. And then he started school. And it all went horribly wrong. My confident, articulate, happy child turned into a very unhappy little boy who didn't want to go to school. He couldn't function. He didn't seem to have any classroom skills at all. So what happened? It seems that very early on in his development, something was not neurotypical. Neurotypical development always occurs in the same way in neurotypical people. So we have conception here, we have birth, we have the first year of life. And anyone who's neurotypical follows that same path. Somewhere along the line, he deviated from that and became neurodiverse. And I didn't know any of this back then. He came home from school day one of year one with a note in his book saying, Toby can't track. So I rang my father, who was a dyslexic teacher at the time. I said, Daddy, note home from school, Toby can't track. And he said, oh, chances are he's dyslexic. Chances are he has Erlen syndrome. Don't worry, by the time he's 12, he can probably just about read his name. So we took him to an educational psychologist who diagnosed very severe dyslexia. We took him to a pediatrician who diagnosed possible social communication disorder. I'd never heard of that. So I did what we do, and I Googled it. And I sat researching for 3 days, reading, just wanted to know what was going wrong with my son. After 3 days of intense reading and learning, believe me, I learned quite a lot, I found a website of a woman in America called Svea Gold, and I contacted her, and she sent me a screening, and I did the screening on me, my husband, all the parents, our parents, and then I did it on my son. So by then I'd got a fairly good idea about our neurodevelopmental status. I found out when I screened my son that he had no ability to track. Do you know what tracking is? Tracking is your ability to keep your head still and follow a moving object. Okay. Now he couldn't do that. Also, his eyes were not working together. That meant that he had no depth perception, no 3D vision. So for example, if I hold my finger up to somebody and ask them to touch the top, if they can't do that, then their eyes are not working together. So I'd say to my son, over there, and he had no concept of what over there was, because to him everything was on the same level. So he couldn't do that either. Svea sent me some exercises, which I did with him. In 3 days, he could track, and in 17 days, his eyes started working together, which was just the most lovely story. We were sitting in bed one night, not ready for bed, we were just sitting on my bed reading a book, having a cuddle, and our feet were straight up, so our feet were there. Then there was the end of the bed, and then there was the wall. And he said to me, Mummy, it's all looking different. And I didn't realise what he was saying at the time. What's different? And he was going, everything's different. And eventually I worked out from what he was saying that he got his yoked eyes and the feet were in front of the end of the bed and the end of the bed was in front of the wall. It was just lovely because I knew that his eyes were starting to work better and he could see what over there was. So exciting. It changed his life. He could now go to a party and not get really upset. Before that, if I ever took him out to a party, he would cling on to me and say, Mummy, just get me out of here, don't talk to anyone. But the combination of the tracking and the 3D vision enabled him to function much more happily within his environment, and that was a really big thing. So I spent the next few months working with Toby, my son, on his exercises, and everything changed. He was much happier. He started to be able to function at school, and people started noticing the change in him because it was so dramatic. A few weeks later, I started getting phone calls from people saying, we've heard about you. Whatever it was you did with your son, will you do for us? And I said, well, I don't really know what I'm doing, but I'll show you what I did. So families started turning up from Suffolk and London and Hertfordshire, just literally within a few weeks of me learning this. So I'd be talking to Svea, help, what do I do? And she'd go, oh, just do this. And so I did it. And these children started to improve dramatically. And I realised, it took me about a year, I realised I'd built an accidental practice. People were coming from all over. People were flying in from Saudi and France to see me. They'd come down from Scotland. They came from all over. I had patients in Silicon Valley, South Africa, all over the place, wanting me to help them. Very surprising. You don't expect that. So what is it that we do? What is it? Okay. So you remember I said to you about neurotypical development always occurs the same way, the process we go through. Well, if you deviate from that, then the senses don't get connected as they should. The brain only knows what's going on because the body tells it. That's a big concept, isn't it? So remember those remaining orphans who were strapped to their cots? Do you remember that on the news a few years ago? They were 10 years old-ish, and they were like newborns. Isn't that curious? What it is, unless you understand, that the brain requires movement. So if you stop a child from moving, you stop all the eyes getting connected improperly in the balance. If you think about human babies, they're born, laid on their back, they're back to sleep campaign, they're in under their baby gym, they're in the car seat, all of that, they're always on their back. But think about cats, dogs, camels, elephants, any quadruped, and they spend their life like this. Okay. Now, it's very important, the stages that lead up to crawling, very, very key. Enable, because once you crawl, doing this movement, you're wiring in the two hemispheres, and you're facilitating reading. So often, you probably know this, the little bum shufflers and the ones who don't crawl, they often grow up to have learning issues, and that's why. Because somewhere quite early on, they deviated from neurotypical and became neurodiverse. So when I scream, I'm screening to see how old the person was when they became neurodiverse. So I've run a series of very simple, very interesting little tests in my clinic, totally non-invasive, and I can establish how old somebody was from conception to birth and afterwards. And then, when I've established that, I can prescribe a series of exercises which repeat the stages they've missed from the stage before the problem occurred. So you can imagine, the closer you get to conception there's a problem, the more severe it is. Whereas if it's around birth and onwards, it tends to be milder. So your dyslexia, dyspraxia, dyscalculia tend to occur here. And your autisms tend to occur around here. And the more severe global delays tend to occur around here. That makes sense, doesn't it? Yeah. So, how do we know that this works? I think it was around the early 1900s. They found out that if you pattern children with cerebral palsy, you can make changes in the brain. You know about this, I can tell by your face.
No, I don't know. I learned from way back, watching Nationwide or something.
Oh, okay. So when you pattern, when you move children with certain neurological conditions into certain positions, you can create changes in the brain. And they discovered, as time went on, that the same applied for autism. They could move children and they could create the changes they required in the brain. Now, in 1986, Rita Levi Montalcini won a Nobel Prize for her work with nerve growth factors. Have you heard of those? Nerve growth factors are what is fired every time we learn something new. So do you remember when you were learning to drive? It's all a bit difficult, isn't it? There's things going on outside, things going on in the car, different things to do with your feet, different things to do with your hands, and it's really overwhelming. Then you've got road signs and junctions and people talking to you, and it seems really impossible. But you repeat and you repeat and you repeat. And then one day, magically, it's automatic. Well, that process is just brain wiring. You're just learning, you're just installing new nerve pathways. And that's all we're doing with neurodevelopment. We are repeating the neurodevelopmental stages where they have deviated from neurotypical into neurodiverse. So what we're doing is we're giving the brain another chance to develop as it might have done had it occurred optimally. Makes sense, doesn't it? I'm going to talk about Irlen syndrome. Now, some of you have mentioned beforehand that you have Irlen syndrome, which is light sensitivity. Now, what's happening with light sensitivity is light hits the retina as light information, and then it gets converted into nerve information. Now, this nerve information, did you know that there are 32 cortical regions of the brain dealing with vision? That's a lot of things to go wrong, isn't it? Isn't that amazing? So we have this nerve information, and we have big cells for colour, small cells for movement in the neurotypical person, and they get put round then into the visual cortex, and that creates our image. In people who have Irlen syndrome, you get big cells for colour and small cells for movement, and it's all getting reversed. So the net effect is light sensitivity. And I had this, and my son had this. He couldn't look at white paper with black writing without getting an instant headache. Now, I have Erlen syndrome and I struggle with yellow paper with black writing. For me, that's an instant headache. When my son was measured up for Erlen glasses at school, I went along and I was trying the lenses as well, and they come singly, you can hold them up and look around the room. And I found some purple ones, purple's my favourite colour. And I tried on these lenses and the whole world just seemed to go all happy. And I said to the woman, this is amazing, I think I've found my lenses. And she said, you think that's good? Go outside. So I said, okay. And Toby and I went outside and I'm looking at the plants thinking, yeah, it's nice, yeah. And then I looked up to the sky and I absolutely had such a shock. Do you know what that was? The clouds were 3D. No one ever told me that clouds weren't flat. I didn't know, because that's how I see clouds. Clouds are just on the bowl of the sky. If you can imagine the sky is like a bowl, the clouds were just glued to the edges and flat. And I put these lenses on and the clouds were hanging in mid-air and they were three-dimensional. I was gutted. Oh no, I've missed that. They look amazing. Do any of you have that symptom? You do. Did you know clouds were 3D?
They never look 3D.
They are 3D. They are gorgeous. They're fluffy things that hang in the sky. And I took the lenses away, bang, flat. Put the lenses back up. Ooh, happy fluffy clouds. Amazing. The point about that is we never know how somebody else is perceiving their environment. Have you heard that sometimes they say autistic children, when they paint the page black, are disturbed because black is a depressed colour? Did you know about that? Have you heard that one? Yeah. Yeah. What about if we look at that a different way? What about if we say, well, their pupils are massive. So what does that mean? Their pupils are really big, so there's too much light going in. What do you do if you're really smart and there's too much light going in? You paint the page black because it doesn't hurt so much. That's a real sign of intelligence. It's nothing to do with being disturbed. Isn't it interesting how you can perceive things differently when you have different knowledge? Yeah. So, going back to Erlen syndrome, my son now no longer needs his coloured lenses since doing the neurodevelopment program, and I didn't even know that was sought outable. No, I thought the glasses, because I've known about Erlen syndrome for 20 years or so, but I just didn't know that doing the program with my son was going to take that symptom away. So he doesn't have that anymore. He's quite happy with white paper and black writing, no problem. So great side effect, don't you think? So lots and lots of things can happen when you do a neurodevelopment program. I've been doing neurodevelopment for 7 years. 7 years ago, when I began, I started treating mostly children. And over the years, as you know, it's an accidental practice. I'm only doing this because people call me, email me, Sue, can you help our child? And of course, I'm more than happy to help people. That's what I'm on this planet for. And over the years, other accidental things seem to have happened. Nowadays, lots and lots of adults are coming because there seems to be a lot less shame involved in having a learning difficulty. Whereas when I was at school, it's a real stigma to have a learning issue. But nowadays, not a problem. I'm dyscalculic. And although I do my neurodevelopment exercises and I'm now capable of doing some maths, I still need to be taught maths because I don't teach anyone to read. I facilitate their brain into a state where they can learn to read. And now I need to learn maths. Difference, isn't there? So what else am I doing? Last year I went on the radio in Suffolk and I did an hour-long interview which you can listen to on my website. And somebody heard that and invited me to give a speech at the Boeing conference. So I went along, gave my talk at the Boeing conference, and a lot of them wanted to learn neurodevelopment. So I wrote a course for them. So now I'm training people to do neurodevelopment, and I love that. I'm training the next 2 weeks. It's really brilliant, because then it's not just me doing this, there's more people that I can share this with. And I'm also being asked to work with various other people, write books with other people. The guy who called me the child brain whisperer, George Helu in Australia, I'm developing various products with him and working on books with him and all sorts of things. Very exciting. And I'm also working on various sales training programs. And I've also just recently been asked to give an inspirational speech, which is very different from this. That's much more upbeat, because it's a whole other ball game. I've just written another book, which I published last week. The nutrition information in there, I used to sell that on my website for £30. That's now in there with all my other stuff, just for a tenner. So it's apart from anything else, that's really good value if any of you want to buy that. My nutritional information, do any of you work with nutritional staff with special needs? No. You know, I mentioned my father earlier. In fact, I didn't, did I? My father has ADHD. And people with ADHD tend to have quite bad food issues. Do you know, you probably know that, don't you? You don't? Oh, people with ADHD and autism have a lot of food issues. But way back in the 70s, my mother was listening to the radio, and she heard about the Hyperactive Children Support Group, which was just starting up by Sally Bundy. And my mum wrote to them, and she got all their nutritional information, sent it through to my father, and he put us all, the entire household, on his elimination diet, and we found out his sensitivities. So his big one is sodium nitrite, which are preservatives in bacon. They make him hallucinate. It's nasty stuff for him. Oh, yeah. Foaming at the mouth, oh my goodness, really bad, yeah. His other worst one is monosodium glutamate. He really can't have that either. Now, so since I was a child, back in the 70s, I've been raised knowing the massive awareness of how food can impact people with special needs, basically, although I didn't realise that at the time. So I've written a big old chunk of book on helping people with special needs with their food, a lot of tics. Epilepsy and so on as well can be helped with certain diets. I've helped a few people with that too. So that's the kind of knowledge that we've got. And Dee and I are going to be working together on training nannies and the people you work with, yeah, if you want to come and learn neurodevelopment. And I have to say, this is the best job in the world. When you have somebody, oh, it's just a joy. When you have somebody who's unhappy, they can't function, they're very, very distressed, and all you do is some movement to reprogram the brain, but skilled movement, you can change a life. But not only that, you change a child, or you help a child, and you help the entire family. It really is the most blissful work, and we have a lot of tears in my clinic. It's a joy, it's just the most lovely thing, when you're really deep help. So the range of things I generally work with are dyslexia, dyspraxia, dyscalculia, which I have, ADHD a little bit. I don't treat much autism, although this program has been working on that for years. Mutism, I'm doing tons of work with mutism. Who knew? Yeah, mutism.
Really interesting, I find it fascinating. I've got quite a few kids with.
Yeah, and neurodevelopment works a treat with mutism. In my book, I've got lots and lots of quotes from little children with mutism saying, "Mummy, I think these exercises are helping me," and they just come out with it at dinner. It's just awesome. So yeah, we're doing really good work with mutism. So the entire spectrum, really, which is the same thing differently expressed. So you told me earlier you're dyslexic, I'm dyscalculic, same stuff, yeah. So I can relate to you, and I'm also a left-hander. Do we have any more left-handers in the room? Yeah, we have some issues. I've got a big old chunk on there on left-handedness. We have our own special issues as well.
I've never thought of it as a special need.
Yeah, it's not a special need as such, but we think differently. Did you know that?
No.
So let me explain something to you which might be interesting. I hope it is. These guys, the way they think is, Let's just take the alphabet as an example. So the letter A. So they learn the letter A at school. Then they learn the letter B. See, this is all making sense. They're going, yeah. Then the letter C. And they work their way through the alphabet like that. And then they find out at the end that there's 26 letters. It's not how we think. Unless you're left hemisphere dominant, and then that is how you think. That's not how I think.
No, I learned that from a very long time ago.
Yeah. So, but this applies to the way we learn. So we learn in global form. So there are 26 letters, and these are their names. So we need the global view before we can understand the detail. So when we are taught detail, we're always looking for the overview. And we find that frustrating, and that can, you know, set us back. So being aware that there's a difference between a global way of thinking and a linear way of thinking is really helpful. Plus, I have all my own left-handed spatulas and knives and all that going on in my house, whereas a lot of people...
What I do, I'm really into having left-handed stuff to support me on my journey. Left-handed rulers!
Left-handed checkbook. Mum's got a left-handed checkbook.
Absolutely. So there's lots of little things that make us different, and we think differently, yeah, and we have a whole load of different stuff going on. For example, I did a project at university on handedness and intelligence, and that was interesting because we get called stupid a lot, don't we? Well, I don't know if you do. You don't look like you do. I don't think you're a typical left-hander, really. We get called stupid. Oh, you're so cap-handed. You're so this. You're so that. But actually, we're just different. And I wanted to know, are we stupid? So I did a big project, a literature review on handedness and intelligence, and I found out that we're not more stupid. In fact, we're liable to be a lot cleverer if we are all average. So we do have a propensity for clever stuff, us lefties. So that's the gist of my talk. What would you like to know? I'm sure you've got some amazing questions for me to keep me on my toes, and I'm more than happy to answer.
I do have a question. To one of the ladies who couldn't come today, just texted me saying apologies, and she's asking about oppositional deficit disorder.
Okay, well, labels. Uh-huh. Labels are for jam jars. Shall I repeat the question? I was asked a question, what is oppositional defiance disorder? Well, the way I personally look at this is that is a label, and labels are for jam jars. We need to look at the person. We need to find out what's going on with them, screen them, and deal with their issues. I do not really get caught up in labels. Although, if a parent calls me and says, my child has this, it gives me a guide as to what kind of issues we're dealing with. But actually, it doesn't really matter because I'm looking at the person. This is an individual thing. Find out where their neurodevelopmental status is, and we work with them as an individual. So there are other sensory things we can help with. So some children won't wear clothes. I have my little Mowgli patients who come in, and they've all got their long hair and knickers, and they wore pants, and they won't wear clothes, and it's so sweet. And I know that next time they come, they'll be wearing jeans and have their hair cut because I've helped them, and I'm like, damn, they look so cute. So a side effect also is helping their skin not be so sensitive. But we have got a whole load of things we can do for various other sensory issues. I'm sure you have some sensory questions for me. Do you have any sensory questions for me? Or any other questions for me? You've got a stack of questions. Oh, come on.
I just can't think of it. If you talk about something like it, then I can blurt something out.
Okay. Yep.
I've got a lovely little boy with various issues, one of which is that he's adopted. So actually, we got him very early on. We got him at 9 months. But actually, I couldn't tell you very much about his gestational development. I do know that he was very late with his milestone development before we got him. So he like sat up on the last possible day that he could have done before something had happened, for example. But he's got various issues, but one of his particular issues is he's very strong reaction to smells.
Yeah.
So perfume, not so much, but things that he would say were, you know, unpleasant smells. The cleaner used on the blackboard, for example, was picked up a long time ago by his teachers. But any particularly strong smell would really upset him. I think he's learned over the years, he's 10 now, he's learned to sort of stand it a little bit better, but they still really offend him.
Yeah.
There are three typical sensory reactions when there's an issue. There is underfunctioning, overfunctioning, and a white noise. So he's overfunctioning. His smell is too sensitive. So it's not calibrated properly. If you can think about it, like the volume on an old stereo where you've got nothing to 10, his is just cranked up really high. So what we would do is we'd recalibrate that. So in a book called, I think it's Disconnected Kids, I think it's something like page 163 or something like that, I can tell you later, there is the most wonderful exercise, but I'm just calculating, so it's probably page 60. there's the most wonderful exercise for smell, which one of my colleagues in America, who's also trained by Svea, she uses a lot and she talked to me, and that's quite a good method for recalibration. Now, on recalibration, I've got really sensitive hearing. I can hear at 3 decibels. So sound is painful, really painful for me. I'm okay with the kind of sound we have in here, but I would quite happily walk around with headphones on all the time. And the upshot of being noise sensitive is that sudden loud noises, like Ed on the way, he was clapping his hands, and I said, please don't do that because you're going to make my head hurt for days. And that's unusual because you don't react like that, do you? You don't react like that. It's something particular to me. And that's something else we need to be aware of when we're working with our people with sensory distortions, because that's a colossal sensory distortion, that you just don't know how they're perceiving the world. But something you can do is rub the earlobes, because when you rub the earlobes, you calm down the hearing. So if you think about it, if I'm going to come up to you and pop a balloon, pull me in the face, you pull. That's it. Okay. That dampens the sound.
I'm so very sensitive. To bass sounds, my migraines, I go crazy. And
bass sounds? Bass. Oh, I'm not good with female opera singers. Okay, so I won't see you in the opera concerts then.
No, and that says that makes my migraines. They're just trigger. I can see all dots and everything.
It's really good when we have somebody with sensory distortions here to share, because when we can look at our little ones whose care we have, whether it's our own child, whether it's a child that we're looking after, or we don't understand why they behave in a certain way. But if you can understand the sensory reasons behind it, then it makes so much sense. When I screened my son, and I found out that he had no 3D vision, no tracking, goodness knows what was going on with him, I found it so humbling that he was living this oversensitive, painful experience, and he was being constantly told off and judged, not by me, but you know, people would be very judgmental of him. And his, you know, when we were out, he would cling on to me, "Mommy, Mommy, don't look at me, don't talk to me." People really thought he had a problem. But if you understand the hell they're going through, it really helps you have so much more compassion for those little people who are doing their best. Because basically, we all want to please, don't we? We all want to fit into a community. We all want to please. We all want people to like us, and we all want to be happy. So imagine the pressure you're under when you can't do that, because life hurts.
So I have another question that came in today, and one of my nannies actually is having a particular difficulty with a child that I believe is autistic. He does not enjoy swimming, and he gets into so much trouble that he's been actually expelled by 2 separate swimming kind of countries. What do we do here?
Well, we could look at the overview, because I'm a left-hander, and I'll do that, and we could say it might be the smell of the chlorine.
Ah.
It might be, the smell! And then he goes into panic mode, then he's been told off, and he's seriously triggered. It's association. Every time you mention swimming pool, he's going to get upset. Is there any surprise? No! Then you might get into the fact that he's got to get into water, that is probably an offensive temperature for him, and it's horrible. And then
the noise,
the smell, the feel, and then
quite a lot of my little ones who come to see me for treatment, and particularly this will apply to, I really think it would apply to a child who's been diagnosed with autism, they really struggle with doing things with opposite sides of the body. Okay, so certain swimming strokes are not going to happen. They might be lucky to do a breaststroke like that, but swimming, they're going to sink because the brain is not well enough coordinated. So swimming is really such a challenge for people with multi-sensory problems, and he would classify as that. If he's having such a strong reaction that two schools have excluded him, I just, oh my heart goes out to him. I think that is so sad, especially as we know how to help probably quite a lot, if not all of his symptoms, and give him a much happier life.
So would you suggest no swimming?
Absolutely, for quite a long time, until the poor little thing's got himself sorted out.
Okay.
I never, ever support torturing people. And he's telling you that that's hell, and I would never, oh no. You've got to wait until his brain is sorted out enough for him to be able to deal with that. You know, where is our love and compassion for these people who are suffering? It's a no-brainer, isn't it?
I think it's very difficult for parents because in one hand you explain a mask and want a child to be able to swim and say, well, if something happens.
It's not going to happen. It's absolutely not going to happen. You can't make that child suddenly like it by force. It's not going to happen. Instead, what we have to do is create a space that they can step into and feel confident. And that doesn't just apply to our special needs children, that applies to any situation. Nobody wants to be forced to do anything. Whereas if somebody creates an invitational safe space, so maybe for a child like that, a neurodevelopment program, and then going into the baby pool that's warm, where it's quiet. I mean, they do theatre, they do cinema, for children who have autism, where the lights and the sound are specially calibrated. Why not have a swimming session for children who've got sensory needs? Why not create an environment of safety and security for their torture? No, cannot agree to that.
Could you just do, like, have water play out, like as an encouragement to be in the water or around the water?
If it works,
yeah,
do it. If you find a way that works, absolutely. But I cannot support doing things that hurt people. When you look at it like that, the way I've explained it, it's really not an option.
Yeah. We sometimes have special sessions at the special schools and stuff in Kenya, where they have like special lights and it's really warm and it's very quiet and they have a specialist teacher and it's not like a swimming lesson. It's very different, and maybe that would be a way.
That sounds perfect. And somebody is using their compassion and their brain to realise that you can't force people to do things. It's obvious, isn't it? Yeah, you wouldn't torture somebody else and make them do scary stuff. So why do it to a child with a label? It's madness. It is, isn't it? Absolute madness.
Yeah,
it doesn't work. You do not get any sort of result except trouble.
It gets worse because then there's a fear and then getting told off for doing it, and then it makes it even scarier because you're getting shouted at.
It's a cycle, isn't it?
Yeah,
every time you go swimming, they're
going to
think they're just going to get shouted at.
Yeah. So we have to just think about the sensory limitations that people have and help them.
Can I ask you a question? My son has two adopted children, and they're blood brothers, so same genetic background, we hope, I think. But one has learned to overcome some of his sensitivities, for example, to sound, both very sound sensitive, but my other one has eventually learned to cope with it. For example, we could not take him into a cinema until he was about 9.
How old is he now?
He's now 11.
Okay.
But we would take him to the door. The younger one was fine with sound in that environment, but he couldn't bear it. So we'd take him to the door and we'd say, you have a choice here, you don't have to go in if you don't want to. And having done that for a few sessions, he then suddenly decided, I think he was actually with a friend, and he went in and managed that. And he's done that with all sorts of other little issues that he's managed to self-manage, if you like. And he can cope in mainstream school. My youngest one, I'm not so sure. I think he needs extra help, and we're just in the process of finding that. Obviously, that's why I come on this evening.
Yeah.
That's one of the avenues. I'm not sure that he can cope in mainstream school. But I've tried heaven's hard and I can't find anywhere that I think would be appropriate for him for some sort of education. I don't expect him to come out with, you know, a super degree or anything like that. He may want to, I don't know. Is there anything in your experience, a sort of an educational setup, that would be therapeutic and good for him?
Somewhere he'd be happy.
Somewhere where he'd be happy, because he's finding school quite unhappy at the moment.
A lot of children with issues like that are homeschooled, and some go to special schools. Mm. Some get on fine in mainstream, it's individual. So I think it depends how lucky you are to find a school in your area that can cater for you. So, but do a neurodevelopment program and just see how he gets on. Yeah, you might just find that it really helps him calibrate his senses so that he can have a more happy, comfortable life.
Yeah.
Does that help?
Yes. There's a fantastic school in Cambridge that's taken on the boy that I used to nanny.
He's autistic and he's got dyslexia and dyspraxia and many other things. And he was struggling in mainstream, but he didn't fit anywhere. When he didn't fit in a special needs school or a mainstream school, he was sort of in between.
Yeah.
And he's just gone to secondary school, actually, in year seven, and he's gone to, it's in Abington, it's a private school.
It's next to the international school.
Joshua goes to the sister school tonight, he goes to Sanctum Wood.
Oh, Sanctum Wood.
Which is great, and he has extra help in the classroom, but I still think with 17 people in the class, it's just too many for him. Yeah. And as you say, I don't think he's a special needs. He's not that disabled that he would fit into an all special needs school. So it has been mentioned homeschooling to me, but I'm absolutely terrified about it because I'm not trained in that particular area. I think he would miss out on the social activities that the school take part in. And one of the things he is quite keen on and really tries hard on and works hard at is sport. And although he doesn't understand games with rules, regulations like football and rugby so much, but running, for example, he would miss out the competitiveness of being with other children.
What's happened to my son may help you.
Okay.
As you know, when he was six, he was diagnosed with such severe dyslexia that by the time he's 12, he might just about be able to read his name. Okay. He's 13 now, and he's in the top set for maths, he's in the top set for science. He's at the bottom set for English, but at the top of it. He doesn't really have any social issues. He doesn't really have any neurodevelopment issues. The only thing that would give him away is having had quite severe special needs when he was little, is that he's really quite chaotic and he's not very well organised. But gosh, he's 13. So I think that he's done really, really well. And I've treated over the last 7 years several hundred children with many diagnoses and outside the spectrum. So I've treated children with Mebius syndrome, which you probably haven't even heard of, and all sorts of other undiagnosed things. But one of the side effects of certain developmental disorders is that their neurodevelopment gets affected. And so you have it as a kind of concomitant. So you have somebody with a diagnosis and their neurodevelopment hasn't progressed as it may have done. And I work with those children and we really help them as well. We help their neurodevelopment to get to the status that it can be optimally by sorting out their senses. I wrote a big book on, it's a big chapter, on how sensory distortions affect our behaviour. That's quite an interesting one that might help you understand what your son is going through with his sensory limitations. So that's in there as well. So I've updated you on my son, which I think is relevant actually, isn't it? I should have said that earlier to see how he's progressed. But I've treated several hundred children over the past few years and their progress has been absolutely amazing. Hasn't worked with every single child I've worked with, but I don't think that there is something that treats everyone. But I think that my track record has been pretty phenomenal. Nearly all of the children I've helped. I wish it could be all of them, but to help anybody is a big blessing in life, don't you think?
So yes. Another question that came in, I'm so sorry, Andy.
It's all right.
a source of people coming in that are putting down to Ned. Another question was, actually, quite a lot of children who have been diagnosed with something are put on some kind of medication. Retinoid, I believe, is one of them. And I had a question coming in. What is your opinion on that?
Do you want my honest opinion?
Yeah. That, I've asked for an opinion, see. Has to be honest.
When my son was six, this school really insisted, pressurised us a lot to put him on Ritalin. I said, over my dead body, I will never put my child on a Class A drug, a medication, no way. No way, ever. It stunts their growth. Oh, nasty business. No is the answer.
What's the alternative?
There are neurodevelopmental programs such as mine, which have been shown over nearly 100 years to work really well. And then there's a lot of issues with food. As I said before, I work a lot with food. One of the biggest problems with behaviour, which can trigger quite lively behaviour, is gluten.
Mm-hmm.
You knew I was going to say that. Gluten, it's a brain inflammatory. There is so much research on gluten. The work of Lauren Cordain in America, he's done tons of work on gluten and how it's a brain inflammatory. If you take it out of the body, it takes about 3 months for your brain to calm down. And you can do that with fish oil. And there's one I like called Vegipa, which I recommend to my patients. If you don't get the result you want from taking out gluten, sugar, that can have a massive impact. But it works best after you've taken out gluten. And there can be other random things. I've heard of children, not my patients, who've reacted to cucumber. But then you're getting into salicylates. And I've written about that again there. There's tons and tons of stuff. Did I answer your question? Did I go off at a tangent?
No, that's great. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. I have a very happy six-year-old who's doing fine, but he's on the age of two, he's had issues with language processing. I mean, English is his first language, but he's learnt, the only way I can describe it, he's learnt English as though it was a second language. So he started off learning by just mimicking other people's words and then putting sentences together. And even now he speaks very, very slowly. And when he's trying to speak, you can see him kind of thinking about the words and how to put them together. And then he comes out with a sentence. And then often when you explain things to him, you have to be very explicit about how you explain things to him. And you've talked a lot of sort of helping children with sensory issues. Can you help children with sort of language processing and developmental issues?
I've worked with mutism quite a lot. And it may be that there's an element of that going on there. And certainly that has been helped a lot. The only way we're going to know is to try. I think that's the most honest answer I can give. Because I can't guarantee anything. All we can say is this has worked for other children, and we just repeat the neurodevelopmental process. But did you say his other milestones were all in order? It was just
he was absolutely fine. He was a really happy little baby, really normal pregnancy. We didn't pick up on anything. He was up because I've always worked. He was at nursery, and just before his second birthday, the head of the nursery picked up. Sammy's just not starting to speak as he should do. And that's when we were first alerted to the fact there might be something going on. And then he went through a phase when he was 2, 3, 4, when he used to have awful temper tantrums and get really, really frustrated. But that's because he had all the ideas going round in his head and wasn't able to articulate them. And he's now 6 and a half and he's much calmer because he can speak, but he still doesn't speak as you'd expect another 6-year-old, 6 and a half-year-old child to speak. So, you know, he's very happy at home, he's doing really well at school, but, you know, what we're just looking for is anything that might help him and support his development further.
Well, a neurodevelopment programme might just do that.
So as a parent, how do you arrange consultations with you?
Good question. I can book you in for a Saturday, usually, because that's what people need, or the school holidays at any time. A first appointment is 2 hours usually, and you come, and I make my clinic very welcoming. So I make sure I know your name, your husband's name, child's name, so I greet you like old friends so that your child feels immediately very, very safe when they come in. And we have a cup of tea, cake if necessary, biscuits, all that jazz, just to make everyone feel very, very warm and safe and cosy. Because children who've got issues are used to being made wrong, they're used to being told off, and they're used to being prodded and poked some of the time and been made to feel very uncomfortable. So we don't have any scary stuff. It's very, very lovely, safe environment. And I will do some really fun tests. Now, I will mostly start with the parents, because that way, remember I said about creating a space for them to step into feeling safe. I don't start testing the child, because sometimes that's a little bit, oh no, that's too much. Whereas if I test you, the child says, well, hang on a minute, I want to be tested, test me. And then you create a safe space for them to walk into, you invite them into, and it works really well. So we spend about an hour fiddling around with some really fun stuff, and I give them a science lesson, and I teach them about how the brain's working. What I'm actually doing is assessing them, and how they're doing for this and how they're doing for that. So I write it all down. And then when I've got my findings, then I prescribe usually a series of exercises, and sometimes also maybe some food stuff or maybe some other sensory things, depending on what you need. And then you go away with that, with all nice laminated sheets. You do the process every day, and then you come back after about 4 or 5 weeks for another hour, and we have a little chat about progress, what's happening, and where you're at. And most people report such a much happier level of being. And then I will adjust the exercises to where you're now at. Then you go away for several months, maybe 4, 5, 6 months, depending on your child's issues, and you come back, and then I give you another set of exercises. And if you have any other issues going on, we can treat that as well. Okay. So that's generally the process. But if you wanted to come and train to do neurodevelopment, the practitioner course is 2 days, where we learn about screening sensory issues, and then the exercises is 3 days, so you learn about what to do to sort out all the sensory problems, and it's brilliant fun. You want to come? Yeah. Oh, I'm so happy, I'd love to train you. Oh, you'd love it. Yeah. It's just the most
massive thing.
Yeah, my students who come, they're just shell-shocked by the information, because it's what they've always wanted to know, and they've been searching for it their entire life, and they come and see me and it's like, I've needed this forever, and they do really find it life-changing. It's just the most joyous thing, it really, really is. I'm so happy you want to come and train. You'll love it. Yes?
No, I was going to say I want to do it.
Oh, okay, I'd love it, I'd absolutely love it. I'm training for the next 2 weeks, so if you're both working out, you would have to book you in a special, Yes?
It's just a question about one of my relatives, actually. I think she's in her mid to late 30s, and she's got, I don't know actually what the condition is, but she looks about like she's in her teens or something. And she's my auntie, and my granny's never really sort of explained to me what it is. And I think she's numb or something. She can only sort of grunt, and she can't write, or I don't know whether she's very good at reading. Obviously she doesn't speak. And she lives in a home with, I think, probably about 4 or 5 other people. And is it something to do with what you were talking about? Or?
It sounds to me like there's a lot more going on. Mm. But because of whatever that is, it will have impacted her senses, yeah. So there will be some sensory stuff, but that's not the root of it in her case. So a sensory program will probably help her be a bit happier, might help her get some level of language, who knows. But it's not going to probably sort out her entire issues. That sounds way complex. Mm. But you never know. You never know.
Interested.
Yeah. We're always learning. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. Any more questions? No. Now, I want a question for you now. Have you enjoyed watching me give a talk? Yeah. Has it been thought-provoking?
Yeah.
Have you felt like you've learnt a lot?
Yes.
Yeah, that's really good to know, because I like to help people, and I only do this, as you know, because my phone rings and people ask me, and also I love doing talks, so when I do a talk, I want to make sure that you feel like you've really gained something valuable that you've never heard anywhere before. Is that the case?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I find it scary that it hasn't ever been mentioned, because I've worked with disabled children with various problems for years,
yeah.
And yet I've never heard of what you're talking about,
yeah.
Which I find quite scary.
Isn't that a tragedy?
Yeah, it's scary. Why haven't I heard of it before? Yeah. I've had so much training and I've never heard of it.
There are several reasons why. When my son was diagnosed with dyslexia, I was told, there's no cure, you have to learn to live with it.
But that's the same with me.
I said, watch me sort it out. And now I say, don't let the people who tell you it can't be done stop you doing it. My son could not function. And they were gonna just, you can't do anything. He's just gonna grow up like that. No, you mean you're gonna deny me the chance to even look for help for him? Oh, no, that was not okay with me. And so that changed my life. I went out on a mission. I've been told before there's no cure, you have to learn to live with it. I'm gonna tell you a story. Do you want a story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please.
This is a sad story. When I was 19, I had the worst case of glandular fever on record at the time. And one Saturday night, when I hadn't actually had anything past my lips, not even painkillers, because I couldn't swallow them, my jaw dislocated. My jaw was right forward. I couldn't eat, I couldn't swallow, I couldn't drink, I had no energy in me anymore. And this Saturday night, I started to choke. I don't know if you know about glandular fever, it's disgusting. All my throat came up with hideous blisters and they would burst and send all this yucky stuff down my throat. Anyway, I know, I was choking with all that. And I saw my life flash before me. I was lying on the sofa in the sitting room and I saw my life flash before me. And I'm having a conversation with myself. I'm saying, Sue, you can't die. You're 19. Come on, girl, fight this. And I was saying to myself, I have no energy in my body. How am I going to fight this? And I was saying to myself, you've got to fight this. I must have gone blue or something because my mum and my sister ran out to the kitchen to get a knife to give me a tracheotomy. And I'm thinking, well, I just want to breathe. And eventually, I think they were on their way back in to see me with this knife. I managed to cough. And that changed my life because I was very close to not making it. And it was a virus. I was 19. How could I be left to die? That really bugs me. And it really bugs me that our kids are not looked after. How dare anyone tell us it can't be sorted out? How dare they let us not even try? You see my passion. When I was 25, I had irritable bowel syndrome. Again, I was told there's no cure, you have to learn to live with it. I said, nonsense. I went out. That's why I ended up at 30 learning homeopathy at university, because I sorted myself out. It's not that hard. Just a bit of diet, a bit of massage, and a bit of this and that. I haven't had that in 23 years. So, by the time my son was 6 and he was diagnosed with something, I already come across a heap of stuff that they said there's no cure, you have to learn to live with. I wasn't going to believe that nonsense. Do you find this inspiring?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good, because that is me, that is my message. I want you to just learn from this inspiration and just hold that in you and just remember stuff. People can't limit you, how dare they? I would say more.